I posed the question earlier as to whether continuous cover forestry is too good to be true. So I'm going to ask you to explain what some of the drawbacks are. And I'm particularly interested in the effect it has on, let's say, the volume of timber that is available from a woodland, because I think our viewers know my day job is that I'm a timber merchant and I rely on timber from woodlands like this for our business. So I guess I'm a bit of a skeptic in terms of whether selectively harvesting trees will actually reduce the availability of timber in the future versus what we might call the more traditional methods of clear cutting.
Well, in my view, there's no reason why, if you've got a fully developed, irregular forest, that it can't produce the same volume of timber that an even-aged clear-cut system is going to produce over the same period of time. You're literally cutting the increment, which is the growth of the tree over periods of time, on a cycle, rather than leaving everything to the end. So there's no reason why a fully developed irregular forest, which is at its sort of static state, isn't going to produce the same volume of timber. As long as you keep harvesting, it'll keep growing. And that's the fundamental thing with a regular forest. As soon as you allow growing stocks to get too high, i.e. you don't fail or harvest, it compromises the whole system and the structure. Everything slows down. So it's very important to cut the increment.
And I'm assuming for the owner of the woodland, it's actually more beneficial to have a regular, if smaller, income rather than, as you say, a bigger income, but at much, at a given time when the entire woodland is felled.
Yeah, I think that you could argue here that you could pursue a smaller scale clear fell replant and still give a regular income to the owner. It's the other benefits of the resilient sustainability that we're pursuing irregular forestry.
Would it be fair to say that the model is that you are aiming for value rather than volume?
I would say the model is we're aiming for the same volume that we could produce on a clear fell system, but we're improving the value of what's in the stand because we have freedom to remove lower quality stems in that stand on a very regular basis. The target is to always seek to improve the potential value of your forest. As soon as actual value equals potential value, you've got there.
Okay, so here's another challenge. Is it not more expensive to harvest trees using this technique than, again, the more traditional technique of actually just clear felling a plot?
Okay, well, of course, if you're clear felling, your cost per cubic meter is going to go down. But in your intermediate thinnings you're doing in your clear fell system, where you're doing low thinnings, you're taking out small trees in your system and not taking out as much volume because you're building the volume in a clear fell system up to the end and then you're knocking it all down in one go. Whereas we're looking to cut the same amount on a 5-year cycle or whatever your felling cycle is, and we're looking to harvest bigger trees rather than smaller ones, because this idea of thinning in the crowns, in the upper story of your forest, so we're taking out big, poor quality stuff, and once we've got rid of those, we can actually harvest stuff that's reached their optimum size. Goshawk, get it. Oh, and the other advantage of in a regular forest is that we don't need to deal with brushwood at all.
And brushwood is, explainer.
Well, it's the lop and top. It's the branches which come off the tree when the harvesting operations go through, okay, which on a clear fell site needs to be cleared up before you replant. Whereas in this structure, it just stays where it falls.
And we can see a bit of it on the ground here. Yeah? Yep, this is the remainder of previous fellings.
And it's all recycled. Yeah, all the nutrients are recycled back into the system and used. The actual cost of moving brushwood is very high, and you completely mitigate that cost in a regular system.
So there are actually, I mean, you've listed quite a few economic benefits of the continuous cover system, as opposed to what, again, what we tend to call the more traditional approaches to forestry. Managing the woodland in the way that you do with this regular silviculture, is it economically viable? Does it pay? Does it make a profit?
Well, yes. I mean, here we've demonstrated it's extremely profitable. 85% of the income generated from the forest is purely from timber sales. And the only times we've had to compromise slightly on the productivity or the profitability is either when we haven't been proactive enough with harvesting, so we haven't generated the income, or when timber prices have been particularly poor.
So I could just stop you there then, to put it in simple terms. Of all of the money that comes into this estate and the estate's woodlands, 85% of it comes from the selling of timber.
Yes.
Yeah. So if you didn't harvest any timber and you didn't sell it, you'd have 85% less money to use in the woodland, managing the woodland.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. I mean, you lose a lot of those benefits that you see now. You wouldn't get if we weren't actively intervening and generating timber sales.
And also, I mean, that 85% pays for you to be here and your team to be here, actively managing this woodland month in, month out, every year. The other thing that strikes me, David, is we're talking quite a lot about harvesting trees, felling trees. And I think in many people's perception is that that can look awful. And to be fair, you know, clear fells can look quite destructive. Mm-hmm. But what strikes me here is you're doing a lot of felling, but actually the woodland still looks beautiful. And I don't think anyone would take a dislike to the way this woodland looks.
No, I'm fair point. And even when we do a felling intervention, it softens so quickly in this environment. And even if you're approaching the forest, it looks great in the distance, but the internal landscape is stunning too.
Now, David, I'm going to press you to be a little bit negative now when it comes to continuous cover forestry. I know that's difficult for you, but I want you just to think about what the barriers and constraints are for this style of forestry. What is it that's putting people off moving into this style of management now, and what might put potential woodland owners, potential foresters off in the future?
Well, there is a challenge there, Tom. And I would say the first thing is you need to be right on it in terms of your silvicultural interventions. So you need to be able to visit your stands on a regular basis to see what the health and status of the forest is and actually determine your interventions and what you're going to remove. It needs to be persistent, your approach and what you're doing. Not just silviculture of how you manage irregular structures, but it's actually having sufficient silvicultural knowledge of how different mixtures of trees interact together and how to treat them, I think, is really fundamental. There's a different approach to how you're actually marking and treating stands. It's easily trainable, and once people have grasped the principles, it's easily achieved.
And it does seem like you are managing to achieve the best of all worlds here. You have a very profitable woodland that is beautiful, that is diverse, that is resilient, that has great access. You know, you are ticking all the boxes. Mm-hmm. So, what could government and what could industry do to help this become a more mainstream way of managing our woodlands for the future?
In terms of government, if they were able to support monitoring what your stands or your trees in your wood are doing, i.e. what is their vitality and how are they growing.
So maybe a bit of funding from government
for that would be really good.
Yep.
If they're able to give some support for people who are undergoing training. I think that it's essential that people have that silvicultural knowledge to be able to deliver these irregular forests.
And what about industry, my industry, the people that come and buy your trees from you?
Yeah.
What could we do to help support this kind of forestry?
What would be really good is if the industry over time becomes more flexible in taking different species and bigger sizes of timber, because I think we definitely need to have a capacity to process mixed species of conifer and ideally some larger dimensions too of higher value.
Well, I have to say, I've got my eye on that tree behind you.
But do you have any advice for landowners and foresters who are considering changing the way they manage their woodlands to something closer to continuous cover or regular style forestry?
Well, yeah, the first thing I'd say is you need to just listen and look at what the forecast is for climate change. It's going to end up with ecosystem collapse at some point, and question ourselves, is even age silviculture sustainable? I think that's really key. Secondly is, as we've demonstrated here, and we are continuing to demonstrate, it's a profitable system to be applying and delivering all your objectives in your forest. It does give a good return. And thirdly is, if you haven't got the knowledge, get some training. There's plenty of people out there now offering training. We used to have to go to the continent.
And you're being very polite there, because you run courses on continuous cover forestry. So just tell us a little bit about those courses.
Yes, certainly, yeah. Well, we've been, when I say we, Andy Poore and myself, through SelectFor Ltd, we've been running about two courses a year now for 15 or so years.
And where can our viewers find out more information?
Well, yeah, we normally advertise them on the SelectFor website.
So I would like to say thank you very much for sparing your time and imparting a very, very small amount, I feel, of your vast knowledge of this subject.
No, you're very welcome, Tom. And it's, on my part, it's a privilege to be involved here and a privilege to be talking to you about it. And I know that Nick and Henry Hoare will be very pleased that you wanted to visit and you've done this. Thank you.
Thank you. When it comes to the future of forestry and woodlands in the UK, there is no silver bullet, there is no one size fits all. We need lots more woodland and we need a wide variety of types. But continuous cover forestry, or irregular forestry, as David described it, does seem to offer a blueprint for creating high quality multifunctional woodlands. Thank you for watching this episode of Wood for the Trees. To find other episodes, please visit our YouTube channel. Thank you.